A long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. Plagiarist Films presents Star Wars Cloak of Deception by James Luceno, narrated by an artificial intelligence. After 1,000 generations of peace, the Galactic Republic is crumbling. On Coruscant, at the center of civilized space, greed and corruption riddle the Senate, beyond even the abilities of Supreme Chancellor Valorum to remedy. And in the outlying systems, the Trade Federation dominates the hyperlanes with its gargantuan vessels. But now even the Trade Federation finds itself assailed from all quarters, preyed upon by pirates and raiders, and victimized by terrorists who demand an end to the Federation's tyrannical practices. It is a time that tests the mettle of all those who strive to hold the Republic together, none more than the Jedi Knights, who have long been the Republic's best hope for preserving peace and justice. Part 1. Dorvala. Chapter 1. Luxuriating in the unfailing light of countless stars, the Trade Federation freighter revenue lazed at the edge of Dorvala's veil of alabaster clouds. Indistinguishable from its myriad brethren, the freighter resembled a saucer whose center had been pared away to create two massive hangar arms and a stalked center sphere that housed the great ship's hyperdrive reactors. Forward, the curving arms fell short of each other, as if in a failed attempt to close the circle. But in fact, the gap was there by design, with each arm terminating in colossal docking claws and gaping hangar portals. Like some gluttonous beast, a Trade Federation vessel didn't so much load as gobble cargo, and for close to 3 standard days, the revenue had been feeding at Dorvala. The outlying planet's principal commodity was Lommet ore, a major component in the production of transparasteel viewports and starfighter canopies. Ungainly transports ferried the strip-mined ore into high orbit, where the payloads were transferred to a fleet of self-propelled barges, tenders, and cargo pods, many of them as large as shuttles, and all bearing the spherical flame sigil of the Trade Federation. By the hundreds, the unpiloted crafts streamed between the Dorvalan transports and the ring-shaped freighter, lured to the breach in the curving arms by powerful tractor beams. There, the docking claws nudged the crafts through the magnetic containment fields that sealed the rectangular maws of the hangars. Safeguarding the herd from attacks by pirates or other raiders flew patrols of bullet-nosed quad-thruster starfighters, wanting shields but armed with rapid-fire laser cannons. The droids that piloted the ships answered to a central control computer located in the freighter's center sphere. At the aft curve of the center sphere stood a command and control tower. The ship's bridge occupied the summit, where a robed figure paced nervously before an array of inwardly inclined viewports. The interrupted view encompassed the distal ends of the hangar arms and the seemingly ceaseless flow of pods, their dorsal surfaces aglow with sunlight. Beyond the arms and the rust-brown pods spun translucent white Dorvala. "Status," the robed figure hissed. The Revenue's Nymoidian navigator responded from a throne-like chair set below the burnished floor of the bridge walkway. "The last of the cargo pods is being taken aboard, Commander Dauphine." Nymoidian speech, while lilting, favored first syllables and elongated words. "Very well then," Dauphine replied. "Recall the starfighters." The navigator swiveled in his chair to face the walkway. "So soon, Commander?" Dauphine ceased his relentless pacing to cast a dubious look at his shipmate. Months in deep space had so honed Dauphine's natural distrust that he was no longer certain of the navigator's intent. Was the navigator questioning his command in the hope of gaining status, or was there some good reason to delay recalling the starfighters? The distinction troubled Dauphine, since he risked losing face by airing his suspicions and being proven wrong. He decided to gamble that the question had been prompted by concern and contained no hidden challenges. "I want those fighters recalled. The sooner we leave Dorvala, the better." The navigator nodded. As you will, Commander. Captain of the Revenue's skeleton crew of living beings, Dauphine had a pair of front-facing red oval eyes, a prominent muzzle, and a fish-lipped slash of mouth. Veins and arteries pulsed visibly beneath the surface of puckered and mottled pale green skin. Small for his species, the runt of his hive, some said, behind his back. His thin frame was draped in blue robes and a tufted, shoulder-padded mantle more appropriate for a cleric than a ship's commander. A tall cone of black fabric, even his headpiece suggested wealth and high office. The navigator was similarly attired in robes and headpiece, though his floor-length mantle was solid black and of a simpler design. He communicated with the devices that encircled the shell-like pilot's chair by means of data readout goggles that cupped his eyes and a disc-shaped comlink that hid his mouth. The Revenue's communications technician was a jowled and limpid-eyed Sulliston. The officer who interfaced with the central control computer was a Gran, three-eyed, with a hercine face. Beaked and green-complexioned, the ship's assistant bursar was an Ishi Tib. Dauphine hated having to suffer aliens aboard his bridge, but he was compelled to do so as an accommodation to the lesser shipping concerns that had allied with the Trade Federation, small companies like Veraxo Shipping, and powerful shipbuilders like Tagaco and Horsch Kessel. Humaniform droids saw to all other tasks on the bridge. Dauphine had resumed his pacing when the Sulliston spoke. Commander, Dorvala Mining reports that the payment they received is short 100,000 Republic credits. Dauphine waved his long-fingered hand in dismissal. Tell her to recheck her figures. The Sulliston relayed Dauphine's words and waited for a reply. She claims that you said the same thing the last time we were here. Dauphine exhaled theatrically and gestured to a large circular screen at the rear of the bridge. Display her. The magnified image of a red-haired, freckle-faced human woman was resolving on the screen by the time Dauphine reached it. I am not aware of any missing credits, he said without preamble. The woman's blue eyes flashed. Don't lie to me, Dauphine. First it was 20,000, then 50, now 100. How much will we have to forfeit the next time the Trade Federation graces Dorvala with a visit? Dauphine glanced knowingly at the Ishi Tib, who returned a faint grin. Your world is far removed from normal space lanes, he said calmly toward the screen. As far from the Rima trade route as from the Corellian trade spine. Your situation, therefore, demands additional expenditures. Of course, if you are displeased, you could always do business with some other concern. The woman snorted a rueful laugh. Other concern? The Trade Federation has put everyone else under. Dauphine spread his large hands. Then what is 100,000 credits, more or less? Extortion is what it is. The sour expression Dauphine adopted came naturally to his slack features. I suggest you file a complaint with the Trade Commission on Coruscant. The woman fumed. Her nostrils flared and her cheeks reddened. You haven't heard the last of this, Dauphine. Dauphine's mouth approximated a smile. Ah, once again you are mistaken. Abruptly, he ended the transmission, then swung back to face his fellow Nemoidian. Inform me when the loading process is concluded. Deep in the hangar arms, droids supervised the disposition of the cargo pods from traffic stations located high above the deck. Humpbacked craft with bulbous noses that gave them an animated appearance, the pods entered through the hangar's MagCon orifices on repulsor lift power and were routed according to contents and destination, as designated by codes stenciled on the hulls. Each hangar arm was divided into three zones, partitioned by sliding bulkhead doors, 20 stories high. Normally, Zone 3, closest to the center sphere, was filled first. But pods containing goods bound for destinations other than Coruscant or other core worlds were directed to berthing bays in Zones 1 or 2, regardless of when they were brought aboard. Scattered throughout the hangars were security automata toting modified Blastech combat rifles, some with dispersal tips. Where the worker droids might be hollow-bodied ASPs, limber-necked PKs, boxy GNKs, or flat-footed binary load lifters, the security droids appeared to have been inspired by the skeletal structure of any number of the galaxy's bipedal life forms. Lacking both the rounded head and alloy musculature of its near cousin, the protocol droid, the security droid had a narrow, half-cylindrical head that tapered forward to a speech processor, and at the opposite end, curved down over a stiff, backwardly canted neck. What distinguished the droid, however, was its signal boost backpack and the retractable antennae that sprouted from it. The majority of the droids that comprised the Revenue's security force were simply appendages of the freighter's central control computer, but a few had been equipped with a small measure of intelligence. The foreheads and chest plastrons of these lanky commanders were emblazoned with yellow markings similar to military unit flashes, though less for the sake of other droids than for the flesh and bloods to whom the commanders ultimately answered. OLR-4 was one such commander. Blaster rifle gripped in both hands and angled across his chest, the droid stood in zone 2 of the ship's starboard hangar arm, halfway between the bulkheads that defined the immense space. OLR-4 was aware of the activity around him, the current of cargo pods moving toward zone 3, the noise of other pods settling to the deck, the incessant whirs and clicks of machines in motion, but only in a vague way. Rather, OLR-4 had been tasked by the central control computer to watch for anything out of the ordinary, for any event that fell outside performance parameters defined by the computer itself. The resounding thud that accompanied the roosting of a nearby cargo pod was, given the size of the craft, well within those parameters. So too were the sounds emanating from inside the pod, which could be ascribed to a shifting of whatever cargo the pod contained. But the same couldn't be said for the hissing of pressure relief valves, or the metallic clanks and stridencies that prefaced the slow rise of the pod's uncommonly large circular forward hatch. OLR-4's long head pivoted, and his oblique optical sensors fixed on the pod. Magnified and sharpened, the captured image was transmitted to the central control computer, which instantly compared it to a catalog of similar images. Discrepancies were noted. Even as OLR-4's photoreceptors were scrutinizing the rising hatch, additional security droids were already hurrying to assume positions on all sides of the suspect pod. OLR-4 planted his boot-like feet in a combat stance and leveled his blaster rifle. The open hatch should have revealed the interior of the pod, but instead it exposed what seemed to be yet another hatch, sealed shut. OLR-4 did succeed in identifying the composition of the inner hatch, but the droid's puny processor was not up to the task of making sense of what it was seeing. That was the province of the central control computer, which was quick to solve the puzzle, though not quick enough. Before OLR-4 could move, the inner hatch had telescoped from the pod with enough force to launch 2 security droids and 3 worker droids halfway across the hangar. Immediately, OLR-4 and 3 others opened fire on the battering ram and the cargo pod itself, but the blaster bolts were deflected and sent ricocheting through the hold. A pair of droids leapt onto the wide-bodied pod, hoping to attack the striking device from behind, but their efforts were in vain. Blaster bolts found them first, quartering one, and all but obliterating the other. It was only then that OLR-4 realized, in his limited capacity, that there were unfriendlies behind the battering ram. And judging by the precision of the bolts, the intruders were flesh and bloods. With cargo pods gliding overhead and 100 labor droids continuing to tend to their tasks, oblivious to the firefight occurring in their midst, OLR-4 rushed to one side, firing steadily and intent on gaining a better vantage on the intruders. Bolts sought him as he moved, sizzling past his head and shoulders and streaking between his pumping legs. In front of him, 2 security droids lost their heads to well-placed shots. A third droid remained intact, but dropped to the deck nevertheless, hopelessly dazzled by untamed, coruscating electrical charges. OLR-4's internal monitors told him that his blaster was overheating and close to depletion. Though obviously aware of the droid's predicament, the central control computer did not countermand its orders. So OLR-4 kept firing while he attempted to angle behind the battering ram. Off to his right, another droid was blasted from the top of the pod, its torso sent twirling in clumsy circles as it flew off into the hangar, only to collide with a settling cargo pod. A droid with a missing leg hopped as it shot, until its sound leg was blown out from under it, and it fell, skidding across the deck, sparks flying from its vocoder chin. OLR-4 shifted left and right, dodging blaster bolts. He had almost reached the pod when a bolt caught him in the left shoulder, spinning him through a complete circle. He staggered but somehow managed to remain upright, until a second bolt struck him in the opposite shoulder. Spun through another circle, he landed on his back, with his legs wedged beneath the pod. Looking up, he had a glimpse of the armed force that had infiltrated the freighter. A dozen or so bipedal flesh and bloods, sheathed in mimetic suits and black body armor, their faces hidden behind rebreather masks, whose oxygen recyclers resembled fangs. OLR-4's photoreceptors focused on a human with long black hair that fell in thick coils to his broad shoulders. The servo motors of the droid's right hand tightened on the blaster's trigger bar, but the fatigued and overheated weapon's only response was a mournful whirr as it powered down and shut off.
Uh-oh,
OLR-4 said. Glimpsing him, the long-haired human swung and fired. OLR-4's heat sensors redlined and his overloaded systems wailed. Circuits melting, he relayed a final image to the central control computer, then winked out of existence. The reassuring hum of machines on the revenue's bridge was interrupted by a grating tone from the scanner array. Gliding across the command walkway, Dalte Dauphine queried the droid stationed at the scanner.
Long-range monitors report a cluster of small ships advancing all speed on our position,
the droid answered in a metallic monotone.
What? What did you say?
The Sulistan elaborated. Authenticators identify the ships as cloak shapes and one Tempest-class gunship. Dauphine's jaw dropped. An attack?
Commander,
the droid intoned. The ships are continuing to advance. Dauphine gestured wildly to the outsized display screen. I want to see them. He had started for the screen when another worrisome tone sounded, this time from the station of the systems officer, which was also set below the walkway. The central control computer is reporting a disturbance in Zone 2 of the starboard hangar arm. Dauphine gaped at the Gran. What sort of disturbance? The droids are firing on one of the cargo pods. Those brainless machines. If they ruin any of the cargo... Commander, starfighters are on screen, the Sulistan reported. It could be nothing more than a glitch, the Gran went on. Dauphine's blinking red orbs darted from one alien to the other in mounting concern. Starfighters changing vector, breaking into two elements. The Sulistan turned to Dauphine, flying the imprint of the nebula front.
The nebula front!
Dauphine rushed to the display screen, then raised his long, fat forefinger to indicate the jet-black gunship.
That ship! The Hawkbat!
The Sulistan said in a rush. The ship of Captain Cole.
Impossible!
Dauphine snapped. Cole was reported to be at Malastare only yesterday. Jowls quivering slightly, the Sulistan regarded the screen.
But that is his ship, and where the Hawkbat ventures, Cole is not far behind.
Starfighters are forming up for attack,
the droid updated. Dauphine turned to the navigator. Enable defense systems. Central control computer reports continued blaster fire in the starboard hangar. 8 security droids destroyed. Destroyed? Defense system has the nebula front starfighters in target lock. Deflector shields are raised.
Starfighters firing!
Intense light exploded behind the rectangular viewports and shook the bridge hard enough to rattle a droid off its feet.
Turbo lasers responding!
Dauphine swung to the viewports in time to see hyphens of pulsed red light streak from the freighter's equatorially mounted batteries. Where is our closest reinforcement?
One star system distant, the navigator said.
The Inquisitor, more heavily armed than the Revenue.
Send a distress call.
Is that wise, Commander?
Dauphine understood the implication. Rescue was always a belittling event, but Dauphine was certain that he could offset the humiliation by protecting the Revenue's cargo.
Just do as I say, he told the navigator. Starfighter elements are forming up for a second run, the Sulistan updated. Where are the starfighters? Why aren't they moving in to engage?
You recalled them, Commander, the navigator reminded. Dauphine gestured wildly.
Well, relaunch them. Relaunch them. Central control computer requests permission to isolate Zone 2 of starboard hangar.
Seal it!
Dauphine sputtered.
Seal it now!
Chapter 2. The masked group that had infiltrated the Revenue were a diverse lot, as varied as the starfighters that were flying support. Humans and non-humans, male and female, stocky and slender. Protected by camouflage suits and matte black armor plate, and sporting grip-sole deck boots and combat goggles, they emerged from behind the battering ram that had afforded them an element of surprise, firing state-of-the-art assault rifles and shoulder-slung field disruptors. The handful of security droids that were still standing collapsed to the deck, limbs splayed or hopelessly entwined. The human OLR-4 had nearly gotten the drop on, strode fearlessly to the center of the yawning hangar, checked a readout on his wrist comm, and tugged the rebreather and goggles from his face. The firefight had left a vagrant tang in the air, the smell of ozone and scorched alloy. Atmosphere is enabled, he told the rest of his band. But oxygen levels are equivalent to what you'd find at 4,000 meters. Off your masks, but keep them handy, especially you tobacco addicts. With some muffled laughter, the team complied. Beneath the apparatus, the human's dark-complexioned face was still a mask, thickly bearded with coarse black hair and rashed from temple to temple with small diamond-shaped tattoos. His violet eyes surveyed the damage with obvious dispassion. There wasn't a security droid in sight, but the deck was littered with their remains. Labor droids of several varieties continued to route a few pods to berthing spaces. A human member of the team kicked aside the severed arm of a security droid. These things could be dangerous if they ever learn to think straight. Shoot straight, the bearded man amended. Tell that to Rasper, Captain Cole, another said. Boiny, a Rodian. It was a droid that sent Rasper on his way. A green-skinned and round-eyed male, Boiny had a tapered snout and a crest of pliant yellow spines. A lucky droid, a luckier shot, a Rodian female remarked. That doesn't mean we treat this like an exercise, Cole warned, eyeing everyone. The central control computer will be deploying backup units soon enough, and we've got a kilometer to go before we hit the center sphere. The infiltrators glanced down the curved hangar toward a bulkhead that loomed in the distance. High overhead were massive box girders and I-beams, cranes, maintenance gantries and hoists, a puzzle of atmosphere and vectoring ducts. A human female, the only among them, whistled softly. Star's End, you could hide an invasion force in here. As dark-complexioned as Cole, she had short brown hair and an elegantly angular face. Even the mimetic suit could not camouflage her shapeliness. That would mean spending some of the profits, Rella, a male human said. And the Nemoidians don't do that unless they can spend it on new robes. Boiny loosed a high-pitched laugh. You grow up a half-starved Nemoidian grub, that's what happens. Cole raised his bearded chin to two of his band. Stay with the pod. We'll make contact when we have the bridge. He swung to the others. Team One, take the outer rim corridor. The rest of you are with me. The revenue shuddered slightly. Muted explosions could be heard in the distance. Cole cocked an ear. That'll be our ships. Sirens began to blare throughout the hangar. The labor droids stopped in their tracks as a basso rumble gathered underfoot. Rella gazed at the far-off bulkhead. They're sealing off the hangar. Cole waved a gesture to the first team. Move out. We'll rendezvous at the starboard turbo lifts. Set your suits to pulse. That ought to confuse the droids. And use the concussion grenades sparingly. And remember to monitor your oxygen levels. He took a few steps, then stopped. One more thing. You get blasted by a droid. Back to rehabilitation comes out of your pay. Dalte Dauphine stood rigidly on the bridge's walkway, watching in errant horror as the nebula front showed his ship no mercy. The motley starfighters fell on the revenue in full force, picking away at the freighter's fat arms and triple-thrustered hindquarters like ravenous birds of prey. Many of the unshielded droid ships were annihilated as soon as they emerged from the vessel's protective force field. Emboldened by their effortless mastery, the enemy craft violated the embrace the hangar arms threw about the center sphere by strafing the command tower at close quarter. Ion cannon fire from the gunship sent waves of aggravation through the revenue's deflector shield. Violent light washed against the bridge viewports. It was all Dauphine could do to keep himself rooted on the walkway as he cursed the terrorists under his breath. In return for having been awarded what amounted to exclusive rights to trade in the outlying star systems, the Trade Federation had pledged to the Galactic Senate on Coruscant that it would content itself with remaining a mercantile power and refrain from becoming a naval power through the accumulation of war machines. However, the further the giant ships traveled from the core, the more often they fell victim to attacks by pirates, privateers, and terrorist groups like the Nebula Front, whose broad membership had grievances not only with the Trade Federation, but also with distant Coruscant itself. As a result, the Senate had granted permission for the freighters to be equipped with weapons of defense, to safeguard them in the unpoliced systems strewn between the major trade routes and hyperlanes. But that had only forced the raiders to upgrade their armaments and in turn prepared the way for periodic strengthenings of Trade Federation defenses. Skirmishes in the mid and outer rims, throughout the so-called free trade zones, had since become commonplace. But Coruscant was a long way off, even by light speed, and it was not always easy to ascertain who was at fault and who had fired first. By the time matters reached the courts, it often came down to the word of one party against the word of another, without resolution. Things might have gone differently for the Trade Federation, but for the Nemoidians, who were as penurious as they were avaricious. When it had come to fortifying the giant ships, they had sought out the most cut-rate suppliers, and they had insisted that protecting the cargo was their paramount concern. Against all sound judgment, it was the Nemoidians who had dictated the placement of quad laser batteries around the outer wall of the hangar arms. While the equatorial arrangement was adequate for repelling lateral attacks, it proved completely ineffective for countering attacks launched from above or below, where nearly all the freighter's crucial systems were located. Tractor beam and deflector shield generators, hyperdrive reactors, and the central control computer. Thus, the Trade Federation had been forced to invest in bigger and better shield generators, thicker armor plating, and ultimately, in squadrons of starfighters. But starfighter allotments were subject to Senate sanction, and freighters like the Revenue frequently found themselves defenseless against fighter craft piloted by seasoned raiders. Well aware of these shortcomings, Dalte Dauphine saw the ship and its cargo of precious Lamite rapidly slipping from his grasp. "Shields holding at 50%, the Gran reported from across the bridge. "But we are imperiled. A few more strikes and we'll be disabled."
"Where is the Inquisitor?" Dauphine whined. "It should have arrived by now."
A volley from the Nebula Front's gunship, Captain Cole's personal gunship, rocked the bridge. As Dauphine had learned in previous engagements, sheer size was no guarantee of protection, much less victory, and the freighter's 3-kilometer diameter only made it a target that couldn't be missed. "Shields marginal at 40%. "Quad lasers 1 through 6 are not responding," the Celestan added. "The starfighters are concentrating fire on the deflector shield generator and drive reactors." Dauphine firmed his fleshy lips in anger. "Instruct the central control computer to activate all droids, all ship defenses, and prepare to repel boarders," he brayed. "Over my dead body will Captain Cole set foot on this bridge." In the starboard hangar arm, Cole's team had barely made it through the bulkhead door when every device in Zone 3 conspired to prevent them from getting 1 meter closer to the acceleration compensator shaft that connected the center sphere to its embracing arms. Where the worker droids might be hollow-bodied ASPs, limber-necked PKs, boxy GNKs, or flat-footed binary load lifters, the security droids appeared to have been inspired by the skeletal structure of any number of the galaxy's bipedal life forms. Lacking both the rounded head and alloy musculature of its near cousin, the protocol droid, the security droid had a narrow, half-cylindrical head that tapered forward to a speech processor, and at the opposite end, curved down over a stiff, backwardly canted neck. What distinguished the droid, however, was its signal boost backpack and the retractable antennae that sprouted from it. The majority of the droids that comprised the Revenue's security force were simply appendages of the freighter's central control computer, but a few had been equipped with a small measure of intelligence. The foreheads and chest plastrons of these lanky commanders were emblazoned with yellow markings similar to military unit flashes, though less for the sake of other droids than for the flesh and bloods to whom the commanders ultimately answered. OLR-4 was one such commander. Blaster rifle gripped in both hands and angled across his chest, the droid stood in Zone 2 of the ship's starboard hangar arm, halfway between the bulkheads that defined the immense space. OLR-4 was aware of the activity around him, the current of cargo pods moving toward Zone 3, the noise of other pods settling to the deck, the incessant whirs and clicks of machines in motion, but only in a vague way. Rather, OLR-4 had been tasked by the central control computer to watch for anything out of the ordinary, for any event that fell outside performance parameters defined by the computer itself. The resounding thud that accompanied the roosting of a nearby cargo pod was, given the size of the craft, well within those parameters. So too were the sounds emanating from inside the pod, which could be ascribed to a shifting of whatever cargo the pod contained. But the same couldn't be said for the hissing of pressure relief valves, or the metallic clanks and stridencies that prefaced the slow rise of the pod's uncommonly large, circular forward hatch. OLR-4's long head pivoted, and his oblique optical sensors fixed on the pod. Magnified and sharpened, the captured image was transmitted to the central control computer, which instantly compared it to a catalog of similar images. "So it is currency you seek. I had always heard that the notorious Captain Cole was an idealist. Now I see that he is a simple thief." Cole almost grinned. "We can't all be licensed thieves like you and the rest of your bunch. The Trade Federation does not deal in violence and death, Captain." Cole grabbed 2 fistfuls of Dauphine's rich raiment and yanked him halfway out of the chair. "Not yet, you don't." He pushed Dauphine back into the seat. "But we'll save that for another day. What matters now is the Erodium. And should I refuse to submit?" Without taking his eyes from Dauphine, Cole pointed to his Rhodian comrade. "Boyne there, is affixing a thermal detonator to the Revenue's fuel driver control system. As I understand it, the device will trigger an explosion large enough to destroy your ship in... Boiney? 60 minutes, Captain, Boiney shouted, holding aloft a metallic sphere the size of a stink melon. Cole pulled an object from the thigh pouch pocket of his mimetic suit and slapped it against the back of Define's left hand. Define saw that it was a timer, already counting down from 60 minutes. He raised his eyes to Cole's steadfast gaze. About the ingots, Cole said. Dauphine nodded. Yes, all right, if you promise to spare the ship. Cole laughed shortly. The Revenue is history, but you have my word I'll spare your life if you do as you're told. Again, Dauphine nodded. That way I'll at least live to see you executed. Cole shrugged. You never know, Commander. He straightened and grinned at Rella. What did I tell you? Easy as... Captain, Cole's man at the communication station cut him off. Vessel emerging from hyperspace. Authenticators paint her as the trade-fed freighter acquisitor. Rella made a plosive sound. You were saying, Cole? The look Cole directed at Dauphine was one of genuine surprise. Maybe you're not as thick-skulled as you look. He leapt up onto the walkway and turned to the viewport array. Rella joined him. The scenario has changed, Cole announced to everyone. The Inquisitor will launch starfighters as soon as it's within range. Order the Hawkbat to take the fight to the freighter. Dauphine allowed a smile of satisfaction. Perhaps you will have to forego your treasure after all, Captain Cole. Cole shot him a withering glance. I'm not leaving without it, Commander, and neither are you. He reached for Dauphine's left wrist to regard the countdown timer. 55 minutes. Cole, Rella said leadingly. He looked at her askance. Without the erodium, we don't get paid, sweetheart. She took her lower lip between her perfect teeth. Yes, but we have to be alive to spend it. He shook his head. Death's not in the cards, at least not in this hand. Close to the bridge, a nebula front starfighter, chased down by packets of lethal energy, vanished in a nimbus of white-hot gas and debris. Fire from the Inquisitor, one of the mercenaries reported. Sudden disquiet tugged at Rella's features. Cole ignored the look she sent him. Plucking Dauphine from the command chair and standing him on the walkway, Cole shoved him toward the bridge's ruined hatch. Double time, Commander. Our departure window has just narrowed. Chapter 3. In the chaotic gloom of the starboard hangar arm, a final pod moving on repulsor lift toward a Zone 3 docking bay didn't draw much attention. Somewhat turnip-shaped, it was larger than most of the pods that had been routed into Zone 3, though not as large as the one the Nebula Front had infiltrated, and nowhere near the size of some of the ore barges. More, the pod gave no hint that, like the terrorists' craft, it carried a living cargo. Strapped into back-to-back seats were two human males who, in dress, were the polar opposite of Dalte Dauphine. Their light-colored tunics and trousers were loose-fitting and unadorned, their knee-high boots were made of Nerf hide, and they affected neither headpieces nor jewelry. Their modest garments only made their obvious guile all the more mysterious. The fraudulent cargo pod lacked viewports of any sort, but vidcoms concealed in the hull transmitted assorted views of the hangar to display screens inside the craft. On observing the disorder Cole's band had left in its wake, the young man in the forward seat remarked in a nasal voice, Captain Cole has left us an easy trail to follow, Master. He has indeed, Padawan. But the trail you take into the forest may not be the one you wish to follow when leaving. Stretch out with your feelings, Obi-Wan. Fairly squeezed into the aft seat, the older man was also the larger of the pair. His broad face was fully bearded, and his thick mane of graying hair was pulled back from a gently sloping, noble brow. His eyes were a sharp blue, and the bridge of his strong nose was flattened, as if it had been broken beyond the repair of Bacta treatments. His name was Qui-Gon Jinn. His counterpart at the controls of the pod, Obi-Wan Kenobi, had a youthful, clean-shaven face, a cleft chin, and a high, straight forehead. His brown hair was cropped short, save for a short tail at the rear of his head, and a single thin plait that fell behind his ear to his right shoulder, a sign of his Padawan rank. Peculiar to the order to which Qui-Gon and Obi-Wan belonged, the word meant apprentice or protege. That order was known as the Jedi Knights. Master, do you see any sign of their craft? Obi-Wan asked over his shoulder. Qui-Gon turned in his seat to indicate an open pod at the lower left of Obi-Wan's heads-up display screen. That one. They must be planning to launch from the inner rim hangar portal. Set us down nearby with our hatch facing away from their pod. but be mindful not to draw attention. Cole is sure to have posted sentries. Would you like to assume the piloting, Master? Obi-Wan asked peevishly. Qui-Gon smiled to himself. Only if you're tiring, Padawan. Obi-Wan compressed his lips. I'm anything but tired, Master. He regarded the display screen for a moment. I found us a good place. As if under the guidance of droids in the hangar traffic stations, the pod settled on its quartet of disc-shaped landing gear. The two Jedi fell silent while they watched the vidcam feeds. After a long moment, a pair of human males emerged from Cole's pod, oxygen masks covering their faces and disruptor rifles cradled in their arms. You were right, Master, Obi-Wan said softly. Cole is becoming predictable. We can hope, Obi-Wan. One of the sentries circled the pod, then returned to the open hatch where the other was waiting. Now's our chance, Qui-Gon said. You know, I know what to do, Master, but I still don't understand your reasoning. We could surprise Cole here and now. It's more important that we discover the location of the Nebula Front's base, Padawan. There'll be time then to put an end to Captain Cole's exploits. Qui-Gon inserted a small breathing device into his mouth and flipped a switch that opened the circular front hatch. A cacophony of skirling sirens greeted them. The two Jedi climbed out into the red glow of emergency lighting that suffused the hold. No object was more symbolic of the Jedi Knights than the polished alloy cylinders Qui-Gon and Obi-Wan wore on the hide belts that cinched their tunics. With the belt's abundance of utility pouches, the 30-centimeter-long cylinders might have been tools of a sort, and indeed, the Jedi viewed them as such. But in fact, they were weapons of light, actual and figurative, and had been employed by the Jedi for thousands of generations in their self-appointed mandate to serve the Galactic Republic as the stewards of peace and justice. The crystal-focused lightsaber, however, was not the true source of a Jedi's power, for that sprang from the omnipresent energy field that permeated all life and bound the galaxy together, an energy field the Jedi knew as the Force. Tens of thousands of years the Order had devoted to the study and contemplation of the Force, and as byproducts of that devotion had come powers beyond the ken of ordinary folks. The power to move objects at will, to cloud the thoughts of lesser minds, to peer forward in time. But most of all, the ability to live in symbiotic accord with all life, and thus be allied to the Force itself. Moving with preternatural silence and swiftness, Qui-Gon advanced on Cole's pod, the lightsaber gripped in his right hand, concealing himself at every opportunity behind other pods. With all the noise in the hangar, he knew that it wasn't going to be easy to distract the two guards. But he had to buy Obi-Wan at least a few moments. Sprawled atop the curving nose of one of the pods was what remained of a battle droid's upper torso and elongated head. Glancing at Cole's sentries, Qui-Gon thumbed the activator button above the lightsaber's ridged hand grip. A rod of brilliant green energy hissed from the sword's alloy hilt, thrumming as it came in contact with the thin air. With a single one-handed swipe of his lightsaber, Qui-Gon cleaved the droid's head from its thin neck. At the same time, he extended his left hand, palm outward, and with a blast of force power sent the severed head hurtling across the hangar, where it struck the deck with a strident clank, not 5 meters from where the terrorists stood. The pair swung to the sound with weapons raised. And in that instant, Obi-Wan disappeared in a blur, headed for Cole's pod. Mid-level in the freighter's center sphere, Cole, Rella, Boyne, and the rest of Cole's band gazed wide-eyed and open-mouthed at the cache of erodium ingots, which had been removed from the Revenue's security cabin and piled, lovingly, atop a repulsor sled. Hypnotic in their beauty, the ingots glowed with a constantly shifting inner light that summoned all colors of the rainbow. Even Dauphine and his 4 bridge officers could scarcely tear their eyes away. Take my breath and call me Wheezy, Boyne said. Now I've seen it all. Cole snapped out of his reverie and turned to Dauphine, whose thin wrists were secured in shiny stun cuffs. You have our gratitude, Commander. Most Nemoidians wouldn't have been so obliging. Dauphine glowered. You go too far, Captain. Cole's broad shoulders heaved in dismissal. Tell that to the members of the Trade Federation Directorate. He nodded to Rella to get the sled underway, then took Boyne by the shoulders and steered him toward an inset control panel. Patch into the central control computer and tell it to run a diagnostic on the fuel drivers. When the computer locates the thermal detonator, it should order an abandoned ship. Boyne nodded in comprehension. Be sure to convince it to jettison all the cargo pods and barges, Cole added. Dauphine's eyes widened in revelation. So the Lomite is important, after all. Cole turned to him.
You're confusing me with someone who cares one way or another what goes on between the Trade Federation and the Nebula Front. Dauphine was confused. Then why are you saving the cargo? Saving it? Cole put his hands on his hips and laughed heartily. I'm merely providing the Inquisitor with a target-rich environment, Commander. With the same extraordinary nimbleness that had guided him to the terrorist's pod, Obi-Wan returned to the Jedi craft. Everything is in place, Master, he said, just loudly enough to be heard over the wailing sirens. Qui-Gon motioned him toward the hatch, but Obi-Wan hadn't even raised a foot when all the pods in the hangar began to levitate and wheel toward one hangar portal or another. What's happening? Qui-Gon looked around in mild perplexity. They're jettisoning the cargo. Hardly the act of terrorists, Master. Qui-Gon's brow furrowed in thought. The central control computer wouldn't allow this unless the freighter was in serious jeopardy. Perhaps it is, Master, Qui-Gon agreed. Either way, Padawan, we're better off inside our craft. Unless Cole has failed in his mission, he should be arriving at any moment. Barely keeping pace with the ingot-heaped repulsor sled, Cole's band jogged down the broad avenue of the starboard hangar toward the rendezvous point. The Revenue's bridge crew struggled to keep up, despite being equipped with rebreather masks, and even when prodded in the back by the emitter nozzles of the terrorists' blasters. To all sides of them hovered cargo pods and tenders, moving toward inner and outer wall hangar portals. Even Cole was out of breath by the time everyone reached Zone 3 and the waiting pod. Only one member of the first team, a blonde-furred Bothan, had made it back, but Cole refused to concern himself just then with the fate of the rest. Every member chosen for the operation had been apprised of the risks. Get the erodium stowed, he shouted to Boyney through the rebreather's communicator. Rella, do a head count and get everyone aboard. Dalte Dauphine glanced worriedly at the countdown timer still affixed to the back of his hand. What is to become of us? He yelled. A human member of Cole's band motioned broadly toward a large nearby pod that had yet to lift off. I suggest you unload that one and cram yourselves inside. Dauphine blinked back panic. We'll die in there. The human laughed scornfully. That's the idea. Dauphine looked at Cole. Your word. Cole twisted his head to one side to read the display on the countdown timer, then cut his eyes to Dauphine. If you hurry, you'll make it to the escape pods in time. Chapter 4. Obi-Wan waited for the terrorist's pod to rise from the hangar deck before activating the repulsor lift engines. In addition to the huge portals at the ends of the hangar arms, magnetic containment portals along the inner curve of the arms had opened up in each zone. Scores of cargo pods and barges had begun to converge on these smaller egresses, but bottlenecks were forming quickly, despite the supervisory efforts of the central control computer. Obi-Wan understood that if they were too late in reaching the portal, he and Qui-Gon would be forced to resort to some other means of abandoning ship. But the young Jedi was nothing if not methodical. He spent a long moment studying the flow of traffic and anticipating where jams were likely to occur before deciding on a course. That course took them straight up into the hangar's lofty reaches of hoists and cranes, before descending acutely for the Zone 3 portal. Grazing three pods on the way down, Obi-Wan neatly avoided a collision with a barge that was fast becoming lodged in the opening. Cole had exited the hangar arm minutes earlier, but the tracker Obi-Wan had affixed assured that the Jedi would be able to single Cole's pod out from the now stampeding herd. We have them, Master, he told Qui-Gon, who was studying the rear display screens. They're heading straight for the center sphere. I'm not certain if they intend to climb over it or dive beneath it, but they are accelerating. Stay with them, Obi-Wan. But keep a fixed distance. We don't want to reveal ourselves just yet. With the bone-white center sphere looming and the broad sweep of the immense arms to either side, the inner district of the annular freighter was a sight to behold, especially with crafts of all size and shape pouring from the holds. But the erratic motion of those same pods and barges left Obi-Wan little time to appreciate the view. He divided his attention between the flashing bezel that was Cole's pod on the heads-up display and the console screens, which showed exterior views to either side. With most of the pods streaming toward the lower portion of the center sphere, even slight encounters were causing chain reactions within the bunch. Many pods were already spinning out of control, and a few were on collision courses for the hangar arms. It all began to remind Obi-Wan of some of the exercises he had endured during his youth in the Jedi Temple on Coruscant,
where the goal of a student was to remain unswervingly attentive to a single task, while as many as 5 teachers did all they could to distract.
"Watch our stern, Padawan," Qui-Gon warned.
A pod had emerged from below them, catching them aft on its ascent. In danger of being tipped end over end, Obi-Wan applied power to the nose attitude jets and managed just in time to stabilize their craft. But the brush had knocked them off course, and suddenly they were closing on the thick structural stalk that wedded the immense center sphere to the hangar arms. Obi-Wan glanced at the heads-up display, but found no pulsing bezel.
"Master, I've lost them."
"Focus on where you want to go, Obi-Wan," Qui-Gon said in a calm voice. "Forget the display screen, and let the Force guide you." Obi-Wan closed his eyes for a moment, then, following his instincts, adjusted their course. Glancing at the display, he saw Cole's pod ahead of them, off to starboard.
"I see them, Master. They're angling for the top of the center sphere."
Captain Cole was never one to remain long in the herd. Obi-Wan fired the pod's attitude jets to adjust course, and soon saw the reassuring blinking of the bezel. The center sphere filled the display screens linked to the pod's nose vidcoms, revealing level after level of what Obi-Wan knew had once been conference rooms and living spaces for the ship's crew, before the Trade Federation had turned to droid labor. They were almost to the crown of the center sphere when a lone starfighter streaked across one of the display screens, dual laser cannons loosing bursts at some unseen target.
"A nebula front cloak shape," Qui-Gon said in mild surprise.
A sturdy, low-profile starfighter with downsloping wings, cloak shapes had been designed for atmospheric combat, but the terrorist group had retrofitted this one with rear-mounted maneuvering fins and a strap-on hyperdrive.
"But what are they firing at?" Obi-Wan asked.
"Cole's pilots must have destroyed the Revenue starfighters by now."
"I suspect we'll know soon enough, Padawan. In the meantime, stay focused on the matter at hand."
Obi-Wan bristled slightly at the mild reprimand, but it was deserved. He had a habit of looking forward, as opposed to staying in the moment, as Qui-Gon preferred, of attending to what the Jedi called the living force. Well above the bald crown of the center sphere and the boxy scanners that topped the freighter's command tower, Cole's pod was gathering speed, and with bold maneuvers was emerging from the cloud of pods within which it had hidden. In danger of falling too far behind, Obi-Wan called on the drives for added power. By the time they were coming around the top curve of the center sphere, Obi-Wan had greatly reduced the distance between the two pods. He was preparing to follow Cole into space when another starfighter, a modified Z-95 headhunter, flashed into view on the display screens and exploded.
"The battle continues," Qui-Gon said.
Emerged from the embrace of the arms, the two Jedi saw the source of the return fire. Floating like a ring above Dorvala's nightside was a second freighter, engulfed in blossoms of fire sown by the nebula front ships.
"Trade Federation reinforcements," Obi-Wan said.
"That freighter could complicate matters," Qui-Gon mused. "But surely we have Cole this time."
"Cole is a sly one, Obi-Wan. He would have anticipated this. He doesn't make a move without a contingency plan."
"But Master, without his support ships..."
"Expect nothing," Qui-Gon interrupted. "Simply stay your course."
Inside the equally cramped quarters of the terrorists' pod, Cole's band of 8 carried out their pre-assigned tasks.
"Outer and inner hatches sealed, Captain," Boyne reported from his wedge of space at the curved instrument console.
"All systems nominal."
"Prepare to convert from repulsor lift to fusual propulsion," Cole said, snugging his seat harness.
"Preparing to convert," Rella relayed.
"Calm is enabled," another said, "switching to priority frequency."
"Clear space, Captain. Passing the 1,000-meter mark from the center sphere."
"Easy does it," Cole said, aware of a certain tension in the recirculating air.
"We'll maintain a low profile until 10,000 meters. Then we go for broke."
Rella cast him an approving glance.
"Plan precisely, perform faultlessly, and avoid detection before, during, and after," Boyne completed.
"Set course for 117, freighter's bow," Cole told them.
"Accelerate to 0.5, fusual thrust on standby." He reclined his chair and switched on the starboard display. The Hawkbat and the support ships had managed to hold the Inquisitor at bay, but the trade-fed starfighters were all over the arena, harried by nebula front pilots and confounded by the torrents of cargo gushing from the Revenue's hangar bays. Still, it was just a matter of rendezvousing with the Hawkbat and putting a couple of parsecs between the gunship and the Inquisitor.
Rella leaned toward him to whisper, "Cole, if we survive this, I forgive you for saying yes to this operation to begin with."
Cole had his mouth open to respond when Boyne said, "Captain, something peculiar. Could be a fluke, but we've got one cargo pod hanging dead on our six." "Show me," Cole said, cutting his violet eyes to the screen. "Smack in the center, the one with the pointed snout." Cole fell silent for a moment, then said, "Alter our course to 119. Rella set herself to the task. Boyne squeaked a nervous laugh. "The pod's changing course to 119. "Some kind of gravity drag?" one of the others asked, a human named Jalen. "Gravity drag?" Rella said in obvious derision. "What in the moons of Bajin is gravity drag?" "It's what keeps Jalen from thinking straight," Boyne muttered. "Fasten it, the bunch of you," Cole said, stroking his bearded jaw in thought. "Can we scan that pod?" "We can try." Cole forced a breath and folded his arms across his chest. "Let's play this safe. Steer us back into the thick of things." "Master, they're scanning us," Obi-Wan said. "They're altering course as well." "They're planning to hide in that cluster of cargo pods," Qui-Gon said, mostly to himself. "It's time we give them something else to worry about, Obi-Wan. Activate the thermal detonator as soon as they're a bit farther from the freighter." Cole gripped the armrests of his narrow seat as the terrorist's pod took a buffeting from its neighbors in the throng that was pouring into the space between the two Trade Federation freighters. "We can't take much more of this," Boyne warned, his sucker-fingered hands gripped on the instrument console. "Cole," Rella said harshly, "unless we get out now, we're going to end up in the middle of a starfighter engagement." Cole kept his eyes glued to the overhead display screen. "What's the pod doing?" "Matching our every maneuver." One of the humans cursed under his breath. "What's in that thing?" "Or who?" another put in. "Something's not right," Cole said, shaking his head. "I smell a womp rat." Boyne glanced at him. "Never met one that could pilot a pod like that, Captain." Cole slapped the armrests in a gesture of finality. "No more wasting time. Engage the primary fusels."
"Now you're talking," Rella remarked, carrying out the command. Without warning, Boyne all but shot from his seat, gesticulating madly at one of the console sensors and tripping over his own words.
"Boyne!"
Cole shouted, as if to break whatever spell the Rodian was under.
"Out with it!"
Boyne swung about, his black orbs radiating incredulity.
"Captain, we've got a thermal detonator affixed to the pod's drive core."
Cole stared at him in similar disbelief.
"How long to detonation?"
5 minutes and counting."
Chapter 5. With its sterile surfaces, sunken control stations, and circular plasma screens that shone like aquariums, the bridge of the Inquisitor was identical to that of her sister ship, save that it held a full complement of bridge officers, and all 8 were Nymoidians. Commander Nap Lagarde gazed out the forward viewports at the distant revenue. At this remove, the bulbous-nosed pods and barges flooding from her cargo holds were mere specks glinting in the sunlight, but magnified views had revealed hundreds of burst pods, the result of collisions and of starfighter laser bolts, their payloads of Lamite surrendered to space. A heart-rending sight to behold, but Lagarde had already decided that he would retrieve as much of the cargo as possible, assuming that the terrorists could be chased off. The stamp of the Nebula Front was all over the crippled revenue, in the form of blistered durasteel, erosed penetrations in the hull, pieces of twisted superstructure. Recently strengthened and overlapping deflector shields had prevented the terrorists from inflicting similar damage on the Inquisitor. More, the Inquisitor carried twice the usual number of droid-piloted craft. No sooner had the freighter decanted from hyperspace than the Nebula Front ships had flown against her. In concert with the freighter's quad lasers, the starfighters had succeeded in warding off the attack and forcing the terrorists back toward the revenue, where the conflict was still raging. Countless droid ships had disappeared in globular explosions, but the Nebula Front had not been spared casualties, having lost 2 cloak shapes and 1 Z-95 headhunter. Only the Hawkbat, the light freighter-sized gunship of the mercenary known as Captain Cole, had been a continuing menace to the Inquisitor, trying the fortitude of the freighter's new shields with disabling runs. Just now, however, even the Hawkbat was in retreat, streaking off in the direction of Dorvala's polar ice cap, the blue vortices of the gunship's thrusters visible from the Inquisitor's bridge. "It seems we have driven them off," one of Lagarde's subalterns remarked in the Nemoidian tongue. Lagarde grunted noncommittally. "Captain Cole must have issued the abandon ship order," the subaltern continued. The Nebula Front would rather see our Lomite lost to space than allow it to reach our customers on Sluis Van. Lagarde grunted again. They may think they have struck a blow against the Trade Federation, but they will think again when Dorvala is forced to make restitution to us. The subaltern nodded. The courts will stand with us. Lagarde turned briefly from the view. Yes, but these acts of terrorism cannot be allowed to continue. Commander, the communications officer intruded. We are receiving a coded transmission from Commander Dauphine. From the Revenue? From an escape pod, Commander. Put the message through the annunciators and ready the tractor beam to retrieve the escape pod. The bridge's speakers crackled to life.
Acquisitor, this is Commander Dalte Dauphine.
Lagarde hastened to the center of the walkway. Dauphine, this is Commander Lagarde. We will have you safely on board as quickly as possible.
Lagarde, listen closely,
Dauphine said.
Contact Viceroy Gunray. It is urgent that I speak with him immediately.
Viceroy Gunray? What is so urgent?
That is for the Viceroy alone to hear,
Dauphine hissed. Realizing that he had suffered a loss of face, Lagarde stung back. And what of Captain Cole, Commander Dauphine? Is he in possession of your ship? Dauphine's brief silence assured Lagarde that the barb had found its mark. Captain Cole fled the ship in a facsimile cargo pod. Lagarde turned to the viewports. Can you identify it?
Identify it?
Dauphine asked sharply.
It was a pod like all the others.
And the Revenue?
The Revenue is about to blow to pieces.
In the terrorist's pod, Boyne studied the instrument console in dismay. 30 seconds to detonation. Cole! Rella yelled when he failed to respond. Do something! Cole glanced at her, tight-lipped. All right, jettison the husk. To a one, the terrorists settled back in relief, while Boyne tapped a flurry of commands into the console keypad. Charges activated, the Rodian reported. Separation in 10 seconds. Cole sniffed. Times like this, you wish you could see the faces of your adversaries. Qui-Gon and Obi-Wan watched Cole's pod on their separate screens. Abruptly, a series of small explosions ringed the humpbacked craft along its equator, and it split into two parts, revealing an oblate shuttle concealed inside. The shuttle's fusel thrust engines ignited, and the craft rocketed away from the pieces of its discarded husk. Then the lower half exploded. That would be our thermal detonator, Qui-Gon said. And the tracking device?
Affixed to the hull of the shuttle and still functioning, Master, Obi-Wan reported, gazing at the flashing bezel. Again you have anticipated Captain Cole. Not without help, Padawan. You know what to do. Obi-Wan smiled as he reached for the controls. I only wish I could see Cole's face. Cole's mouth fell open as he watched the pursuing pod burst apart along a midline seam. Inside was a wingless Corellian lancet, painted a telltale crimson from pointed nose to sleek finned tail.
It's flying Coruscant colors, Boyne said in astonishment. Judicial Department. Matching us maneuver for maneuver, Rella reported as she wove the terrorists' shuttle through a swarm of cargo pods and clusters of loosed Lomite ore.
Gaining on us, Boyne updated. Rella refused to accept it.
Since when do judicials pilot like that? Who else could be piloting? One of the humans asked. It sure isn't Nemoidians.
Cole locked eyes with Rella.
Jedi? They said in unison.
Cole considered it, then shook his head.
What would the Jedi be doing out here? This isn't Republic space. Besides, no one, and I mean no one, knew about this operation.
Boyne and the rest were quick to agree. The captain's right. No one knew about this operation. But the uncertainty in the Rodian's voice was glaring, and Cole was suddenly aware that everyone was watching him.
No one, Cole? Rella said leadingly. He frowned at her. Outside the Nebula Front, anyway.
Maybe the Force told them, Boyne mumbled.
Rella studied the displays. We might still make the Hawkbat. Cole leaned toward the shuttle's wraparound viewport. Where is she?
Holding at the rendezvous point above Dorvala's pole. When after a long moment Cole still hadn't responded, she added, I'll just keep flying in circles while you make your mind up about what to do.
Cole looked at Boyne. Run a surface scan of the shuttle hull.
Surface scan? The Rodian asked dubiously.
Now, Cole said sharply.
Boyne bent over the console, then straightened in his seat.
We're hosting a locator.
Cole's eyes narrowed.
They're hoping to track us.
Correction, Cole, Rella said. They are tracking us.
Cole ignored the remark and glanced at Boyne again.
How much time before the Revenue blows?
7 minutes.
Can you calculate the shape of the freighter's explosion?
Boyne and Rella swapped troubled glances.
To a certain extent, the Rodian said in a tentative voice. Do it.
Then give me your best estimate of the blast radius and the extent of the debris cloud. Boyne swallowed hard. Even my best estimate is going to be plus or minus a couple of 100 kilometers, Captain. Cole mulled it over in silence, then glanced at Rella. Come about. Hard. She stared at him. It's confirmed. You've lost your mind. You heard me, Cole snapped. It's back to the freighter for us. Just inside the MagCon portal of the Inquisitor's portside hangar arm, Dalte Dauphine crawled indecorously from the barrel-shaped escape pod the freighter's powerful tractor beam had retrieved. The navigator and the rest followed him out. Commander Lagarde was on hand to meet them. It is an honor to rescue so celebrated a person, Lagarde said. Dauphine adjusted the fit of his robes and straightened his command mitre. Yes, I'm sure it is, he replied. Did you do as I asked and contact Viceroy Gunray? Lagarde indicated the Nemoidian mechno chair that had probably conveyed him from the bridge. The Viceroy is eager to hear what you have to report, as am I, Commander. Dauphine pushed past Lagarde to get to the chair, which immediately began to move off in the direction of the center sphere, no doubt at Lagarde's remote behest. A product of Afady's craft house of pure Nemoidia, the curious and prohibitively costly device had two sickle-shaped rear legs that terminated in single-claw feet and a pair of double-clawed articulated guidance limbs. The laser-etched designs that covered its metallic surface were modeled after the shell ornamentation of Nemoidia's sovereign beetle. Gyroscopically balanced, the high-backed chair was more status symbol than practical mode of transport. But Dauphine had grasped that the chair had not been provided for his benefit. Where one would have sat was a circular hologram plate, from which projected the miniature hollow presence of Viceroy Newt Gunray himself, leader of the Nemoidian Inner Circle and a member of the Seven-Person Trade Federation Directorate. Impediments of interstellar origin dazed the feed with diagonal lines of noise. Viceroy, Dauphine said, bowing in obeisance before he hurried to catch up with the slowly scuttling chair. Gunray had a jutting lower jaw, and his thick lower lip was uncompanioned. A deep fissure separated his bulging forehead into two lateral lobes. His skin was kept a healthy gray-blue by means of frequent massages and meals of the finest fungus. Red and orange robes of exquisite hand fell from his narrow shoulders, along with a round-collared brown surplice that reached his knees. Around his neck hung a pectoral of elongated teardrops of electrum, and a black tiara, triple-crested with a pair of dangling tails, sat atop his regal head. What is so urgent, Commander Dauphine? Gunray asked. Viceroy, it is my sad duty to report that the revenue has been seized by members of the Nebula Front. The cargo of Lamite ore floats in space, and even as we speak, an explosive device counts down the moments to the ship's destruction. Realizing that he had forgotten to peel the timer from the back of his hand, Dauphine retracted his hand into the loose sleeve of his robe. So Captain Cole strikes again, Gunray said. Yes, Viceroy. But I bring news of an even more distressing nature. Dauphine glanced around him in the hope that Lagarde was out of earshot, but of course he wasn't. The cache of erodium ingots, he said at last. Cole somehow knew about it. I had no recourse but to turn it over to him. Expecting rebuke or worse, Dauphine hung his head in shame as he trailed the mechno chair. But the Viceroy surprised him. The lives of you and your crew were at stake. Just so, Excellency. Then stand tall, Commander Dauphine, Gunray said. For what has happened today may well prove a boon for the Trade Federation and a blessing for all Nemoidians. A boon, Viceroy? Gunray nodded. I order you to assume command of the Inquisitor, recall the starfighters, and withdraw the freighter from combat. Cole is headed back to the freighter, Obi-Wan said from the controls of the Judicial Department starfighter. Could he have tricked the freighter into abandoning its cargo, even though it wasn't in jeopardy? I doubt it, Qui-Gon said. He pressed his face close to the Lancet's transparasteel canopy. All of Cole's support ships, even the Corvette, are distancing themselves from the revenue. It's true, Master. Even the Inquisitor is underway. Then we're safe in concluding that the freighter is marked for destruction, and yet Captain Cole is speeding toward it. As we are, Master, Obi-Wan thought to point out. What could Cole have in mind? Qui-Gon asked himself aloud. He's not a man to undertake desperate acts, Obi-Wan, let alone suicidal ones. The shuttle isn't decelerating or changing course. Cole is shooting straight for the starboard hangar arm. Just where we started. Obi-Wan's brow began to furrow in concern. Master, we're getting awfully close, if the freighter is truly marked for destruction. I realize that, Padawan,
Perhaps Captain Cole is merely testing us. Obi-Wan waited a long moment before he allowed concern to show in his voice. Master? Qui-Gon watched the shuttle angle down toward the center of the circle that was the revenue. Stretching out with his feelings, he did not like what he found. Abort the pursuit, Obi-Wan, he said suddenly. Quickly. Obi-Wan fed full power to the Lancet's drives and pulled the yoke sharply toward him. At full boost, the ship climbed in a long loop away from the freighter. Suddenly, the revenue exploded. In the Lancet's cockpit, it was as if someone had draped a bright white curtain over the canopy. The small craft received a punch in the tail that sent it rocking forward, riding the crest of the detonation wave. Great hunks of molten Dura steel streaked like comets to all sides. The Lancet shook to the breaking point, systems shorting out with showers of sparks and displays showing nothing but noise before they darkened. Glancing over his shoulder, Obi-Wan watched the revenue burst into sections, the massive hangar arms making brief, fist-first contact, then rolling off to opposite sides as two loosed crescents. The center sphere and bridge tower spun away from the destroyed acceleration compensator stalk and what was left of the ship's trio of gaping exhaust ports. Some distance away, the Inquisitor was moving for the safety of Dorvala's dark side. Cole's corvette and two of the support starfighters streaked away from the planet and made the jump to hyperspace. Dorvala is either about to gain a moonlet or fall victim to a devastating meteor, Obi-Wan said when he could. I fear the latter, Qui-Gon said. Contact Coruscant. Inform the Reconciliation Council that Dorvala needs immediate emergency relief. I'll try, Master. Obi-Wan began to flip switches on the console, hoping that at least some of the communication systems had survived the electronic storm that had accompanied the explosion. Is there any sign of Cole's shuttle? Obi-Wan glanced at the display screen. No signal from the tracking device. Qui-Gon didn't reply. Master, I know Cole hated the Trade Federation, but could he have cared so little about his own life? Qui-Gon took a long moment to respond. What are the 6th and 7th rules of engagement, Padawan? Obi-Wan tried to recall them. The 6th is, understand the dark and light in all things. That is the 5th rule. Obi-Wan thought again. Exercise caution, even in trivial matters. That is the 8th. Learn to see accurately. Yes, Qui-Gon said. That is the 6th. And the 7th? Obi-Wan shook his head. I'm sorry, Master, I cannot recall it. Open your eyes to what is not evident. Obi-Wan considered it. Then this isn't the end of it. Hardly, young Padawan. I sense instead a menacing beginning. Part 2. Coruscant. Chapter 6. The four walls of Finis Valorum's office at the summit of the governmental district's stateliest, if not most statuesque, edifice were made of transparent steel, paneled by structural members into a continuous band of regular and inverted triangles. The city planet that was Coruscant, scintillant orb, jewel of the core, choked heart of the Galactic Republic, spread to all sides in a welter of lustrous domes, knife-edged spires, and terraced superstructures that climbed to the sky. The taller buildings resembled outsized rocket ships that had never left their launch pads, or the wind-eroded lava tores of long-dead volcanoes. Some of the domes were flattened hemispheres perched on cylindrical bases, while others had the look of shallow, hand-thrown ceramic bowls with finialed lids. Striations of magnetically guided sky traffic moved swiftly above the cityscape. Streams of transports, airbuses, taxis, and limousines, coursing between the tall spires and over the measureless chasms like schools of exotic fish. Instead of feeding, however, they were the feeders, distributing the galaxy's wealth among the greedy trillion to whom Coruscant was home. As often as Valorum had beheld the view, which was to say nearly every day of his now 7 years as Supreme Chancellor of the Republic, he had yet to grow indifferent to the spectacle of Coruscant. As worlds went, it was neither large nor especially rugged, but history had transformed it into a uniquely vertical place, a vertical experience more common to ocean than atmospheric life. Valorum's principal office was located in the lower level of the Galactic Senate Dome, but he was generally so swamped by requests and business there that he reserved this lofty perch for meetings of a more private nature. Pale hands clasped at his back, he stood at the bank of transparasteel windows that faced the dawn, though daybreak was hours behind him. He wore a magenta tunic that was high-collared and double-breasted, with matching trousers and a wide cummerbund. Southern light, polarized by the transparasteel panels, flooded the room.
but Valorum's sole guest had taken a seat well out of the light's reach. I fear, Supreme Chancellor, that we face a monumental challenge, Senator Palpatine was saying from the shadows. Frayed at its far-flung borders and hollowed at its very heart by corruption, the Republic is in grave danger of unraveling. Order is needed, directives that will restore balance. Even the most desperate remedies should not be overlooked. Although such opinions had become the common sentiment, Palpatine's words pierced Valorum like a sword. The fact that he knew them to be true made them all the more difficult to hear. He turned his back to the view and returned to his desk, where he sat heavily into his padded chair. Aging with distinction, Valorum had a receding cap of shorn silver hair, pouches under piercing blue eyes, and dark, bushy brows. His stern features and deep voice belied a compassionate spirit and questing intellect. But as the latest in the line of a political dynasty that stretched back thousands of years, a dynasty many thought weakened by its uncommon longevity, he had never been fully successful at overcoming an innate patrician aloofness. "Where have we gone wrong?" he asked in a firm but sad voice. "How did we manage to miss the portents along the way?" Palpatine showed him an understanding look. "The fault is not in ourselves, Supreme Chancellor. The fault lies in the outlying star systems, and the civil strife iniquity has engendered there." His voice was carefully modulated, occasionally world-weary, seemingly immune to anger or alarm. "This most recent situation at Dorvala, for example." Valorum nodded soberly. "The Judicial Department has requested that I meet with them later today, so they can brief me on the latest developments." "Perhaps I could save you the trouble, Supreme Chancellor. At least in terms of what I've been hearing in the Senate. Rumor or facts? A bit of both, I suspect. The Senate is filled with delegates who interpret matters as they will, regardless of facts." Palpatine paused, as if to gather his thoughts. Prominent in a kind, if somewhat doughy face, were his heavy-lidded, watery blue eyes and rudder of a nose, red hair that had lost its youth he wore in the provincial style of the outlying systems, combed back from his high forehead but left thick and long behind his low-set ears. In dress, too, he demonstrated singular allegiance to his home system, favoring embroidered tunics with V-shaped double collars and outmoded cloaks of quilted fabric. A sectorial senator representing the outlying world of Naboo, along with 36 other inhabited planets, Palpatine had earned a reputation for integrity and frankness that had set him high in the hearts of many of his senatorial peers. As he had made clear to Valorum in numerous meetings, both public and private, he was more interested in doing whatever needed to be done than in blind obedience to the rules and regulations that had made the Senate such a tangle of procedures. "As the Judicial Department is certain to tell you," he began at last, "the mercenaries who assaulted and destroyed the Trade Federation vessel Revenue were in the employ of the Nebula Front terrorist group. It seems likely that they gained access to the freighter with the complicity of dock workers at Dorvala. How the Nebula Front learned that the freighter was carrying a fortune in Orodium ingots has yet to be established. But clearly the Nebula Front planned to use the Orodium to finance additional acts of terrorism directed against the Trade Federation, and perhaps against Republic colonies in the Outer Rim." "Planned?" Valorum said. "All indications are that Captain Cole and his team of assassins perished in the explosion that destroyed the Revenue. But the incident has had wide-ranging repercussions nevertheless." "I'm well aware of some of those," Valorum said with a note of disgust. "As a result of continuing raids and harassment, the Trade Federation plans to demand Republic intervention, or, failing that, Senate approval to further augment their droid contingent." Palpatine made his lips a thin line and nodded. "I must confess, Supreme Chancellor, that my first instinct was to refuse their requests out of hand. The Trade Federation is already too powerful, in wealth and in military might. However, I've since reassessed my position." Valorum regarded him with interest. "I'd appreciate hearing your thoughts." "Well, to begin with, the Trade Federation is made up of entrepreneurs, not warriors. The Nemoidians especially are cowards in any theater other than commerce. So granting them permission to enlarge their droid defenses, slightly at any rate, doesn't concern me unduly. More important, there may be some advantage to doing so." Valorum interlocked his fingers and leaned forward. "What possible advantage?" Palpatine took a breath. "In exchange for honoring their requests for intervention and additional defenses, the Senate would be in a position to demand that all trade in the outlying systems would henceforth be subject to Republic taxation." Valorum sat back in his chair, clearly disappointed. "We've been through all this before, Senator. You and I both know that a majority of the Senate has no interest in what happens in the outer systems, much less in the free trade zones. But they do care about what happens to the Trade Federation. Yes, because the shimmer silk pockets of many a senatorial robe are being lined with graft from the Nemoidians. Valorum snorted. Self-indulgence is the order of the day. Undeniably so, Supreme Chancellor, Palpatine said tolerantly. But that in itself is no reason to allow the practice to continue. Of course not, Valorum said. For both my terms of office, I have sought to end the corruption that plagues the Senate, and to unravel the knot of policies and procedures that thwart us. We enact legislation, only to find that we cannot implement it. The committees proliferate like viruses, without leadership. No fewer than 20 committees are needed just to determine the decor of the Senate corridors. The Trade Federation has prospered by taking advantage of the very bureaucracy we've created. Grievances brought against the Federation languish in the courts, while commissions belabor each and every aspect. It's little wonder that Dorvala and many of the worlds along the Rima trade route support terrorist groups like the Nebula Front. But taxation isn't likely to solve anything. In fact, such a move could prompt the Trade Federation to abandon the outlying systems entirely, in favor of more lucrative markets closer to the core. Thus depriving Coruscant and its neighbors of important outer system resources and luxury goods, Palpatine interjected, seemingly by rote. Certainly the Nemoidians will see taxation as a betrayal, if for no other reason than the Trade Federation blazed many of the hyperspace routes that link the core to the outlying systems. Regardless, this could be the opportunity many of us have waited for, the chance to exercise Senate control over those very trade routes. Valorum mulled it over briefly. It could be political suicide. Oh, I'm well aware of that, Supreme Chancellor. Proponents of taxation would suffer merciless attacks from the Commerce Guild, the Techno Union, and the rest of the shipping conglomerates awarded franchises to operate in the free trade zones. But it is the appropriate measure. Valorum shook his head slowly, then got to his feet and moved to the windows. Nothing would cheer me more than getting the upper hand on the Trade Federation. Then now is the time to act, Palpatine said. Valorum kept his gaze fixed on the distant towers. I could count on your support? Palpatine rose and joined him at the view. Let me be frank about that. My position as representative of an outlying sector places me in an awkward situation. Make no mistake about it, Supreme Chancellor. I stand with you in advocating central control and taxation. But Naboo and other outlying systems will undoubtedly be forced to assume the burden of taxation by paying more for Trade Federation services. He paused briefly. I would be compelled to act with utmost circumspection. Valorum merely nodded. That much said, Palpatine was quick to add. Rest assured that I would do all in my power to rally Senate support for taxation. Valorum turned slightly in Palpatine's direction and smiled lightly. As always, I'm grateful for your counsel, Senator, particularly now, what with troubles erupting in your home system. Palpatine sighed with purpose. Sadly, King Varuna finds himself enmeshed in a scandal. While he and I have never seen eye to eye with regard to expanding Naboo's influence in the Republic, I am concerned for him, for his predicament has not only cast a pall over Naboo, but also over many neighboring worlds. Valorum clasped his hands behind his back and paced to the center of the spacious room. When he swung to face Palpatine, his expression made clear that his thoughts had returned to issues of wider concern. Is it conceivable that the Trade Federation would accept taxation in exchange for a loosening of the defense restraints we have placed them under? Palpatine steepled his long fingers and brought them to his chin. Merchandise of whatever nature is precious to the Nemoidians. The continuing assaults on their vessels by pirates and terrorists have made them desperate. They will rail against taxation, but in the end they will tolerate it. Our only other option would be to take direct action against the groups that are harassing them, and I know that you're opposed to doing that. Valorum confirmed it with a determined nod. The Republic hasn't had a standing military in generations, and I certainly won't be the person to reinstate one. Coruscant must remain a place where groups can come together to find peaceful solutions to conflicts. He took a breath. A better course would be to allow the Trade Federation adequate protection to defend itself against acts of terrorism. After all, the Judicial Department can't very well suggest the Jedi dedicate themselves to solving the Nemoidians' problems. No, Palpatine said. The Judicials and the Jedi Knights have more important matters to attend to than keeping the space lanes safe for commerce. At least some constants remain, Valorum mused. Just think where we might be without the Jedi. I can only imagine, Valorum advanced a few steps and laid his hands on Palpatine's shoulders. You're a good friend, Senator. Palpatine returned the gesture. My interests are the interests of the Republic, Supreme Chancellor.